Welcome to First Baptist Church of Walnut Creek. We'd like to share with you some of our upcoming church announcements.
You're spinning out of control. So keep going like you got this. Keep smiling just to hide it. Keep moving not to notice. It's slowly taking its toll. The faster you can slow this down to the rhythm of right now, the sooner you find your strength. So hurry up and wait. Rest your
Our scripture reading today is 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. And I, brethren, when I came to you, did not come with excellence of speech, or of wisdom declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I was with you in weakness, in fear, and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Welcome to First Baptist Church. Today we are in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. We are going to be speaking about the gospel focus. For the 1 Corinthian church had divisions in their church because they were evaluating preachers in the exact same way that they evaluated philosophers. They misunderstood the message of the gospel. And in doing so, they also really misunderstood the messenger. The preaching of the gospel is not a philosophical system of ideas to be arranged and then presented by human logic and eloquence. For the gospel message is really the power of God in action. In the second chapter of 1 Corinthians, the Apostle Paul draws our attention to his method of sharing the gospel. And this is critical for us today, because sharing the gospel for many of us has never become really a normal part of our life. We know that it's important, and we acknowledge that it's important, and even some of us out there have taken classes on how to evangelize. And yet, it seems that It's never become part of our life. And if we were to pull our friends or pull congregations to find out how many people have shared the gospel in the last week or even in the last 30 days, we would not be surprised at all to discover that very few, if any, people have shared the gospel with their friends or family or coworkers. But we are reminded that that is an important aspect of the Christian's life. We see it throughout the New Testament that the good news of Christ is shared and declared to all manner of people. Here we find in chapter 2, the Apostle Paul focuses our attention and helps us face some of the same problems. In doing so, we divide this section up into just three simple passages, or three different sections, I guess I should say. The first part is that we're going to look at is the first two verses of chapter 2, and we're looking at Paul's cause. This is what his focus really was, what drove Paul to share the gospel. And the second, we look at Paul's conduct, how he behaved, what was going through his mind when he was sharing the gospel. And lastly, his conviction. What's that driving force where he felt like, I have to share the gospel, because if I don't, woe is me. That push, that internal push that he had. Not because that he was getting paid for it, but because if I don't, all those people I'm in contact with won't have that opportunity to have a life-changing experience, to know the love of Christ, to know the love of God, to have their sins forgiven, to be able to spend all eternity with a Savior who loves and cares for them. So, let's begin in chapter 2, verse 1 and 2, and we'll see the cause of Paul. In verse 1 it says, "And I, brethren, when I came to you," this is really talking about his manner, how Paul came to the believer. It actually also refers to his very first start in the ministry in the city of Corinth. Now, Paul doesn't go into a lot of detail here, but if we were to go back to Acts chapter 18, we would discover the struggle of sharing the gospel and even Paul's decision to quit. That might be shocking to hear, but Paul is opposed verbally while he is there, and he's also physically threatened. Although many Corinthians believed and were baptized, Paul was still considering of leaving the city. It might seem like he had some sort of success, but emotionally, mentally, Paul had come to a spot where he was thinking of, I need to move on. Yet the Lord intervenes and refocuses Paul's cause. He speaks directly to the apostle. In doing so, he says, "Do not be afraid, but speak and do not be silent, for I am with you, and no one will attack you to hurt you, for I have many people in this city." Now, there's no number that's given there, and the Lord is good to his word. For if you continue reading in chapter 18 of the book of Acts, you discover that there was a local group of Jews who bring up a case against Paul, and they haul him to the local authorities. But the local authority does not wish to hear this case because they believe it's just some sort of Jewish law and they're not interested in hearing about it and hearing their disputes. In fact, since they reject to hear it, Paul is released. And the Greek people who are there are so distraught and irritated by not the fact that he's released, but by the fact that the head of the synagogue who brought this case against this individual and is really wasting the time of the Greek leaders and people who are there, his name is Sosthenes, they grab him and they beat him, and the governing rulers who is there just kind of look the other way. Now, let's take a look at something that's extremely remarkable. Turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And in verse 1, Sosthenes is named here. This is Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God, and Sosthenes, our brother. Soseth the enemy becomes Sothis the brother in Christ. How does something like this happen? Now, I'm assuming that these are actually the same people, and I believe that they are. But remember, Paul had been an enemy of the gospel, and Christ had changed him. Paul's manner did not follow the normal expectations and practices of that day. Let's go back to verse 1 of chapter 2. And I, brethren, when I came to you, did not come with excellent speech or of wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. This does not mean that Paul stuttered or had other problems. It's really focusing on his manner. He did not use the normal practices of the day. A speaker is remembered by his style or mannerism or his reasoning skills. How often have you heard a great speaker and someone then prompted you and say, what was the message about? Well, I don't know, but the speaker sure was good. That's what the Apostle Paul is referring to there. He said, I didn't use the standard method of the day. Instead, he was just completely determined for the people to focus on the message, not on his style, not on his delivery. Paul didn't want people walking away and saying, oh, you know that Apostle Paul? He is a fantastic public speaker. Dominant, hypnotized the crowd with his oratory abilities. What skills he has. No, instead, he's just rejecting that style and method of the day. He wants to make sure that everybody's able to just focus on his message. Paul's message, as he says in verse 1, is the testimony of God. And the testimony of God recalls our attention back to Acts chapter 1, verse 8, where the disciples are all told, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, or witnesses to me, in Jerusalem and in all of Judea and Samaria, and even to the ends of the earth. The message centers on Christ alone and in him crucified. That is the focus that we have here. All other questions were just completely set aside. I'm sure people have questions about creation. They had questions about this and about that. But the truth of the matter is, he's not interested in sharing or answering those questions. He's only there to focus on Christ and about the cross. The context of Paul's message was simple and unpretentious. He was not focusing again on delivering an edifying discourse or beautifully putting together or telling a story that would affect people emotionally. He just wants to bear witness to what God has done in and through Christ so that man might be saved. Remember, Paul was not at the cross. Just like you and me, we weren't there, but he tells others what God did through the cross and through Christ so that that story can be told and so that others can be saved. And that's our cause also. We are to do that same thing. So from verse 1 to verse 2, he says, for I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Keep it focused. Keep the thing centered. Don't get sidetracked. That takes us to our second point, the conduct of Paul. Paul's conduct is found in verses 3 and 4. Oftentimes when we read about or we think about the Apostle Paul, we create in our mind an image of this individual who does not really match what Scripture says. We think of Paul the saint, Paul the great evangelist, Paul the fearless individual who takes the word of God and presents it and just everybody responds. But look how the Apostle Paul responds to these fellow brothers and sisters in Christ at Corinth. God's word really tells us and reflects the true situation of what was taking place. In verse 3, Paul says, I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling, and my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. What we have the opportunity to hear about and experience is Paul's emotional state. He says he was feeling weak It means that Paul did not feel up to the task that was laid before him. He was timid when it came to sharing the gospel. Does that shock you? Does that surprise you? Well, it shouldn't, because I'm willing to bet that when you have that opportunity to share the gospel with somebody, you feel exactly the same way. Butterflies fill your stomach. You feel unworthy or unprepared for it. And you feel that you should say something, but you're afraid that the words are going to come out sideways. And God's not going to be pleased, or He's going to be angry with you. Paul's feeling he's afraid that he's not going to share and say it right. The preacher of the gospel is sort of like a piggy bank full of money. Recognizing and realizing that what's inside the piggy bank is far more value than the actual container. You see, the preacher, the speaker, is weak in every aspect. But not only does Paul speak about weakness, he also talks about the feeling of fear. It's a feeling that you receive when an alarm goes off. There's this apprehension that is spread all over your body. You're uncertain of what's going to take place in the next moment. Wow. Perhaps you have had that strange sensation. You see a door that needs to be open, but you're afraid of what might be on the other side. Or you're sitting in the classroom and a teacher has asked you to read a book, or to come up front and do an example on the board. Your hands begin sweaty, or your feet become sweaty, and it feels like your mouth instantly goes dry. What do you say? That's that feeling of fear that the Apostle Paul is trying to communicate. Not only that, there is a physical reaction of fear. Paul says that he's trembling, meaning he's quivering and shaking. It's nervousness. It has a physical effect in which his knees are knocking together. That's right, it's the great Apostle Paul who is speaking the gospel. And it sounds like he's afraid of public speaking. How can this be? Well, it's not impossible. How many of you felt exactly the same way before you've had to share the gospel? And yet we're reminded that the Apostle Paul says in Romans chapter 1:16, he says, I'm not afraid to share the gospel. Or better yet, this is how he says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God into salvation to the Jew first and also for the Greek. Paul understands the full weight of the task that's before him. Do we understand the same? And do we ask ourselves, am I adequate for the task that I've been given? Well, the answer is you are adequate. God has prepared you and made you and has gifted you and has empowered you with His Holy Spirit. But the mental fear is real. But it is overcomable. It can be overcome. Let's look at Paul's mental state. In verse 4, he says, but my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words. Let's start off with what Paul did not do. Paul did not use words that nobody could understand, and neither should we. We should not use words that people can't understand. In other words, don't use words that you don't understand. Use things that you are familiar with. Don't try to sound like somebody else. Sound like yourself. And don't start speaking in some sort of weird style. Be yourself. Don't develop a missionary or a preacher's voice. You know how you talk to your pastor on Monday through Saturday, but when he gets behind the pulpit, all of a sudden his voice changes and he gets into this weird preaching style voice. I'm not knocking that. I'm just saying you probably have noticed that. But when you're sharing the gospel with someone, don't start preaching to them. Just tell them the good news. You see, one of the biggest challenges that young pastors have, young preachers have, is simply just for them to be themselves. There's such a strong desire and impulse to imitate others. Paul's saying, don't do this. And he doesn't. He doesn't copy and follow with what the world does by using persuasive words and human wisdom. Although he can and has the ability to do that, he resists the temptation to do so. But let's look at what he does do. Paul demonstrates the truth of the message. The real work of the message is done by the acts of the Holy Spirit. Although the Holy Spirit cannot be seen, everybody can see the power of the Holy Spirit in action. It's just like the wind moving the trees. You don't see the power of the branches, but you can definitely see those branches being moved by some force. Some might ask in verse 4, is that power of the Holy Spirit the same power that's referred to in chapter 12 when it's talking about the charismatic gifts or the spiritual gifts that are mentioned there? Well, there are some people who think so. But if Paul was stating that, then he would be asking people to display these spiritual gifts before he could determine whether he was going to baptize them or not. And it'd be sad for the Thessalonians because they gave no evidence of these charismatic gifts when they showed faith, love, and hope. And they definitely showed those, and people recognized that in the county that they lived in. So what is this power? It's the same type of power that we see that's shown and revealed through the Thessalonians. It's the gospel that came to them and they revealed that in their life. The Apostle Paul says, for our gospel didn't just come to you in words only, but it also came in power, in the Holy Spirit, and much assurance. Now, saying that is one thing, but showing that is something different. Later on in the same chapter of chapter 1 of 1 Thessalonians, the Apostle Paul says, for that power was seen in a transformational life in which the people that he communicated with, their lives were completely changed. Paul says, for they themselves declare what manner of entry we had among you and how you turned to God from idols. That is a huge transformation that had taken place. People stopped being idol worshipers and started worshiping the one true living God. See, when you receive the word of God, you welcome it. Not really what it is as just, you know, something that someone shared with you, but just like the Thessalonians, you recognize it as it is in truth, the word of God. And that word of God truly does work in people and changes them. It's the demonstration of the power of the gospel that we see when a person receives Christ as their Savior. The conversion of a soul is a miracle in a moment. And we cannot forge it, and we cannot fake it. But when it happens, we all know it because it's unmistakable. And that's what the Apostle Paul presents. And when the believers at Corinth received Christ, it was transformational. And people truly started following Christ. Now, moving to our third and final point. The conviction of Paul. In verse 5, he says that your faith should not be in wisdom of men, but in the power of God. One of the things we have to remember, going back to the first chapter, the Apostle Paul was not seeking followers. Remember, the early church said, hey, I am of Peter, and I am of Paul, and I am of Apollos. And some said, I am of Christ. There was these great divisions in the church. But Paul did not come to Corinth seeking followers. In fact, he wasn't looking to measure the success of his ministry by how many people were believing or how many baptisms for that matter. He was looking at how many people's lives were changed. It's easy to say I'm a believer, but the true evidence is in how a person's life is transformed. Is there a hunger for the things of God? Does a person start desiring to read God's word and to live God's word and obey God's word? When a wife and children have become believers and the father is not a believer, they all recognize that and see that. But when he finally comes to faith, everyone in the family recognize whether it's true or not, because they see all those things that he had struggled with before are changed and he is going through the process of being that godly man that God wants him to be. And they praise God for that. And the same goes with a mother who's not saved or a child who's not saved. A family who sees one of their members come to know Christ, they rejoice and praise God, because when that life is given over and there is a true change, there's no doubt in anybody's mind of what has just transpired. The Holy Spirit is working in a life to be completely sold out for Christ. Paul's conviction has brought him and confirmed that this is what he is here to do. He is at this place to share the gospel with these people. God has told him there are many, many people here, so stay where you're at. Keep preaching the gospel, no matter what. There are people that God has placed in our life that we need to share with. See, Christianity is a person. It's not a philosophy. It's not a how to live a life. It's a relationship with Jesus Christ. Real Christian faith is generated by the power of God. The proof is not in starting churches, but it's really in the application of truth in a person's life. Local churches just become a secondary result of the gospel being spread. So what do we do? Here's a challenge I want to lay out for you in your life groups. I would like you to think of five people who are not believers that are within the sphere of your contact. Meaning these are people that you have contact with in one way or another. You choose how that contact takes place. They might be family members. They might be personal friends. It might be a neighbor. Could be a student or fellow co-worker. But you get the idea. If you can't think of anybody because everybody in your contact list is already a believer in Christ, then I want you to sort of think out the box a little bit. Who are people that you come in contact with? Perhaps you don't know their name and you're unsure whether they're a believer or not. Think of the mail person or one of the delivery people that show up to your door, UPS or FedEx or Amazon. Think of one of those. You don't know if they're a believer or not. Or the person at the grocery store that you always go and see. You see, after a while, some of the same people working there. I think you get the idea of what we're looking at here. Or maybe it's the neighborhood person who walks dogs back and forth all the time. You see that person on a regular basis. That's that contact person. You don't know them by name, and maybe you've only smiled and said hi. But that's the only potential people that you have. I'd like you to take your five group of people and go into your life groups and share those five people with your group. And having done so, the next step, what I want you to do is I want you to brainstorm with how could you share the gospel with those five people. Chances are, if you already knew a way, you would have already done it. But maybe you just need some new ideas, some new fresh approaches, and your life group people will help you in that manner. They'll help give you some fresh perspectives, challenging ways in which you can share the gospel with people in your contact. Now, while you do that, you might also bring up some of the reasons why you are scared to, or you're nervous, or you're afraid of sharing with those specific people. That would give them something for a reason to pray for you, and they might be able to help you in that area also. So your task this week really is to share the gospel with those five people. Having done so, I'm going to just ask you to trust in the power of God to work in those five people. You might think that the biggest task is for you to share the gospel, but that's not it. It's a huge task, and I get that. But share with those five people, and then I just want you to rely on the power of God. Just trust that God will do something in those people's lives. Rely on Him to take His word and do something. If God wants those people to believe because you shared the gospel, you are going to see the immediate result of that to take place. Because it's going to happen real quick. And that will give you something also to pray about this week. So there's your task. We need to be gospel focused. The Apostle Paul was focused. He stayed in the city that he was ready to leave. I'm assuming you're going to stay in the city that you're in for at least a week. In the meantime, let's share the gospel with five people. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for our time together and the challenge that we have from the Apostle Paul's life. Although that fears come to us and we don't understand exactly why we are getting nervous, perhaps we have done this before, but each time that we share the gospel, we seem to shake. We seem to lose our confidence. But Lord, may we just focus that and understand that you are the one who's going to cause all the work to be done. We are just going to try to be obedient to you this week. We pray for these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Enjoy your time with your life groups. Have a great day.